This week on FX Guide TV.
It's our pleasure to sit down with multiple Academy Award winner and VFX industry pioneer, Richard Edlund. We also look at the new range of courses available from fxphd.com for the October term.
This and more coming up next.
Star Wars, Raiders of the Lost Ark, Die Hard. Just some of the films of Richard Edlund. From the earliest days of ILM to Boss Films, Richard's career is incredible. Today, he is as active as ever, and beyond visual effects supervision, he is also a key member of the Academy, the VES, and the ASC. It was our privilege to recently sit down and spend an afternoon with one of our industry's most respected members, Richard Edlund.
Thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
All right.
I was wondering if I could start in your early days.
Okay.
I guess there's a tremendous interest in your, you had a naval career and then a photographic career. And I guess I wanted to start there because one of the pieces of advice I hear quite often, and I get your perspective on this, is that using a stills camera is one of the greatest training tools for visual
right.
effects.
Well, if we go back further than the Navy to my high school, I had a great photo teacher in high school who was like a, he was like a real geek and real super nerd. He taught physics and photography. And so basically I learned the nuts and bolts of photography, including, you know, we had to mix our own chemicals. We learned optics, we learned film structure and all the kind of behind the scenes aspects of photography and so by the time I got out of high school, well, I was the editor of the photo of the
like the yearbook or the
yearbooks, right? So I was the yearbook photographer, and I also shot for the LA Examiner, the Scholastic Sports Association, and I had a 4x5 press camera. It was a Crown graphic. Not a speed. I was always lusting after a speed graphic because you got a thousandth of a second. But actually, the limitation made me a better photographer because I had to learn how to shoot at the peak of action. My high school grades were, you know, if I liked the class, I'd get an A or a B, and if I didn't, I'd get a C or
okay.
D. You know, so I had to take a few classes over in order to even get into USC and do night school. So basically, I had almost a straight A average. I had one B, and so I could have transferred to day school, but then my parents would have to pay even more. And I thought, well, hey, I'm going to just get a job, because I mean I don't need any more schooling. And basically, you know, I learned a lot about the gestalt of the business while I was going to SC, because there were kids that were my classmates who were relatives of, they had relatives in the business. And so basically one of my good friends, his father was an assistant director and
oh, it's an industry town in LA.
Yeah. And so basically I got to know what kind of, how the business worked, you know, the politics of the business. And so I basically put in a resume into the Department of Employment in Hollywood and bloodied my knuckles and got the old, you're in the union? No, then we can't hire you. And then you go to the union. I say, can I get in the union? No, you have to have a job. And, you know, it's like one can't hire the other. So, but anyway, the resume that I left the Department of Employment found its way to Joe Westheimer, who had a company who did titles, opticals, inserts, and you know, various types of shots, special effects shots for commercials, things like that, and for TV shows. And so I went over to, and Joe called me, and I went over to meet him, and about 25 minutes later, he offered me the job.
So now maybe I've got my chronology wrong. So was this the period where you literally featured in the Addams Family?
Yeah.
Okay. You want to tell that story? Because I'm
stunned
by that.
See, the thing is, we shot inserts for a lot of TV shows.
Like Beverly Hillbillies, right?
Beverly Hillbillies. Let's see. let's see, the ones that I remember most, I mean, some of them were just holding a newspapers and stuff like that.
But like Wild Wild West,
but
I think
Wild Wild of, West was fun. We had a lot of weird inserts to do on that. And then we did Star Trek with the original.
Okay, so rumor has it.
Because I was relatively dexterous, I wound up being the hand for the thing in the inserts.
And so I'd be
under the table and...
It's your hand in the credits, right? In the opening title sequence.
In the main title, yeah, is my hand.
But you skipped over Star Trek, because I want to get back to that.
You know, in a lot of the shots. I mean, shifting cars and lighting cigarettes and making, you know...
Hand gestures. Hand acting.
You know, hand gestures, right. And then Star Trek. Well, first of all, besides beaming them up, which we do after lunch... That was like pretty straightforward. It was like a single frame rotoscope, and then I would shoot like reflections from Mercury and various optical, you know, elements in order to make them look kind of, gossamer and twinkly. But Lynn Dunn, who was like the patron saint of visual effects, who actually did the effects for the original King Kong, was one of the houses. There were like four houses that were doing shots for Star Trek. And we were one, and Frank Vanderveer and Film Effects, and I think Modern did some stuff. Anyway, so Lynn did the shot of the Enterprise flyby, but the model was like really big, and so basically when the model got close to the camera, the screen wasn't big enough to cover it, so it went off the blue screen. So I wound up with the job of rotoscoping the model. I had to rotoscope the model, as it was just holding out stars anyway. It wasn't that big a deal, but also the pylon that held it up.
It's kind of ironic. It's not like we ever have anyone shooting off a screen these days.
I know. Well, blue screen was like, see, the thing is, back in those days, and that was when we first started experimenting with blue screen, and Joe and I basically would shoot a wedge for the mat and then send it to the lab, and as soon as it got, and I would be waiting for it to come off the lab, and so I could get back, and so we would then pick the exposure and then shoot the mat. So the soup wouldn't change.
Right.
And get it back, you know, because otherwise if you wait too long, the chemical would change and the mat would be too big or something.
It's just
whatever.
Remarkable, that chemical process in terms of
it was like photomasochism, you know. And it was actually, it got worse at Abel's. That was some time later. But in any case, and then after, I moved Joe to a new studio. We moved, and I was like the guy that did it. I did sweeping up, and I did picking up the titles and running, making film runs to the labs, hand lettering titles, shooting inserts, shooting titles.
Because titles literally were like on a card.
They were on a card. Yeah,
you had to actually make them up.
Right.
Yeah.
And so I hand littered a lot of titles. Yeah. I did Big Valley, and I did Patty Duke and Burke's Law and a bunch of main title shows. And I came up with a look, which was the candy apple neon look that Bob called it.
Okay.
And it was basically animated graphics, and Richard would do graphics, and I did some too. I did the Sunbeam commercial and a couple of other things. But the main thing that we did was the Uncola commercial and the 7-Up Butterfly Girl, which got Bob Cleo's.
Right. Yeah.
And so they were like really hot commercials in 75. And so we were doing, and then from that, we did all of the station breaks for ABC.
The streaking.
Nights of the Movies, all those, you know. Eyewitness News, all those different shows.
And it's from Robert Abels that you get the now famous phone call to come and work on a...
Well, then, you know, the thing is that we all kind of knew about each other. I mean, we knew that Douglas was shooting stuff out in the valley, and John Dykstra was working with him, and Dick Alexander was the machinist at Abel's, and he had known, and Bruce Logan was a guy. Bruce came on, he shot the Death Star exploder with a high-speed camera that we set up.
So I hear you had a pretty serious counteroffer to stay at Robert Abel's, didn't you?
Well, Bob, what happened was I gave Bob a long notice also. I said, Bob, another one of those three-month notice things. I said, I'm gonna leave Bob. I'm gonna do this sci-fi movie, and I was making like about $350 or something like that a week at that time, and I kept getting these $50 a week raises, you know, and so by the time I was leaving, I was making $750 a week, and I was gonna only make $600 a week starting on Star Wars.
Well, thanks.
So I had to take the dock and pay.
Yeah, thank the Lord you did.
But it was the best decision I ever made in my life.
Well, yeah.
And
that was John Dykstra that got you over, right? Mm-hmm. It's John Dykstra that got you over at that point?
Well, John was the supervisor.
Yeah.
And basically, I met with John and Gary Kurtz, and we talked about how we would do this. And we hit it off real well.
Give me some insight into the mindset, like even on that early Star Trek stuff, but on this Star Wars stuff. So we are completely before these become the iconic legendary things that they are today. What was the view? I'm not talking about the plot now, but what was the view of the effects work you were doing? Did it seem experimental? Did it seem like it was an extension of what you'd been doing?
Well, here's the thing. I mean, our idea was, first of all, to make a miniature camera that would shoot miniatures in the same way. So something that was shot with this system would look the same way it would look if it would be shot with a guy with a handheld Aeroflex.
Right.
You know, and so knowing that as you're panning, you're doing a swish pan as this plane, you know, I mean, the background is blurring like crazy. And if you were to try to shoot this stop motion, in other words, shoot a frame, move it, shoot a frame, move it, shoot a frame, move it, which was the old way to do it, it would have juddered.
Yeah.
And it was like the Harryhausen movies, yeah. You know, they you know, the wings are flopping around, you know.
Which means that this computer technology that you'd sort of, I hesitate to use the word computer technology because it evokes the wrong image, but this sort of computerized motion.
Well, basically what we could do now is we could, because the camera could move to make the same, in other words, every time the camera shutter opened, the camera was still moving. And so there would be blur.
Yep.
And the camera, and I had this, I designed this Trojan helmet head that put the head moved here, but it didn't, in other words, if you were to do a tilt like that, the lens would sweep.
Right.
But if you do the tilt like this.
So a nodal pan around the
lens. So it's basically nodal around the, so it's a nodal point head.
Right.
So the pan and the tilt and the roll were all on the nodal point.
Right.
Or very close to it. And so basically that was the system. And then I slung the camera from the top so that we could basically, oftentimes I would shoot shots upside down.
Yeah.
Or sideways even. Yeah. I mean, using gravity to our effect.
I mean, as a kid, I saw you in documentaries doing that stuff, and it really seemed genius. I mean, it seemed incredibly inventive as well as hard work.
Well, that was the thing. I mean, that was one of the tipping points of Star Wars was that I figured, my theory is that there were four tipping points. One was hiring Ralph McQuarrie to do the design. And he basically art directed the entire series. Two was hiring us to do the effects because we were the only ones at that time that really had the chops to do that. Three was Johnny Williams, music. And yeah. Four, and maybe one of the most important, was Alec Guinness. The casting of Alec Guinness, once I heard George had cast Alec Guinness, because I was worried because I thought the movie was kind of a teenage script. And, you know, trust in the Force, Luke, you know, you weren't going to see Lauren Green pulling those kind of lines off. You know what I mean? I was like, who could pull those lines off besides Brando? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And make it play that had the gravitas. But when he hired Alec Guinness, I knew that Jaws was in trouble.
Today, you are obviously very much associated with the Academy. I'm just wondering if you can, not clear up, but just amplify for me, when Star Wars is acknowledged by the Academy in 77, 78, at the next Academy Awards that came around, you effectively win an Oscar, but it's not actually awarded as an Oscar because of the nature of where the visual effects industry was at that time.
No, it was an Oscar. It was we were nominated.
I thought you got a special Oscar that year.
That was Empire and Jedi.
Ah, okay. I apologize.
So Star Wars, we got nominated, and our competition was Close Encounters.
Yep.
And in fact, when we were there at the Oscars, and we're seated, and John is like grinding his teeth, you know, he's like, so he's really, you know, keyed up. And I said, John, I said, relax, we're sitting next to the aisle, you know, we got it, you know.
Is that a tip for today?
Well, you know, they don't actually, I mean, the Academy wouldn't actually look and see because they can't tell, but they can handicap.
Okay.
And I mean, so Star Wars was such an, I mean, people were like, if you went to a party and you hadn't seen Star Wars five or six times, you apologized.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it was like that kind of a social.
So why is it that when the Academy honors the next films, you're not just getting, again, an Oscar? Why is that different?
Well, we got an Oscar.
Well, I'm sorry, you did, but it was a special achievement
award because there was no competition.
Okay, so
I mean, it's like there's like no contest. So I mean, it was like The Empire Strikes Back was so far ahead of any other movie that was out that year that it just became a special award. After Star Wars, I did Galactic, and then I did Star Wars. I did Empire Strikes Back. After Empire Strikes Back, I immediately went into Raiders of the Lost Ark,
which again
I won an Oscar. Yeah. I was like 3 for 3.
Yeah.
And then after that, I did Poltergeist, which should have won the Oscar. But E.T. won that year. But yeah. I mean, Poltergeist was much more complex and much more difficult show than E.T. was. But E.T. was another phenomenon.
I just want to ask you one last question about Raiders. Because it was remarkable in of its own right. I'm just wondering, what was the primary challenge presented there that was very different from what had preceded with Star Wars? Obviously, the locations are hugely different, but from a technical point of view, what was the thing?
I think the main difference was it wasn't a fantasy.
Right.
I mean, it was happening in 1930s America, you know, in the 1930s. And so... So we couldn't get away with certain things we could get away with. I mean, you could get away with fill light in space in Star Wars, which we had to have in order to wash out blue spill. But, for example, there's a lot of other cheats that were possible with... And actually, the walkers themselves, because the walkers were stop motion, they were kind of juddering. But the thing is, they were mechanical objects, and so that kind of worked for them.
Mm. You know,
and they weren't working so fast that it wasn't a big amount of move. So, but there was, it does strobe a little bit, but you buy it because it's a mechanical thing.
So there's a period then that you leave ILM for Boss,
right,
and work on another collection of incredibly landmark pictures.
Well, let's not forget Poltergeist for a minute. Because Poltergeist was actually the most difficult project for me of all of them. Because that was happening next door.
Right.
I mean, that was your neighbor's house. And so consequently, whatever effect that we had to work in that kind of a context. And we couldn't get away with the kind of cheats that we could in Star Wars or those kind of movies.
And I'm thinking
or
that...
Or even Raiders. Because, I mean, Raiders was sort of fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah, it was certainly action and the audience was along for the ride. I'm right in thinking that in the first Poltergeist, you did some of the floating, drifty, wafty stuff as like underwater, right?
Yeah.
Which was tremendous. I remember once I heard that, I was like, I read Cinefix religiously.
Well, and then there was the hallway ghost. Remember the hallway ghost that was up top of the stairs? Well, we did that shot. The guys built the hallway ghost. But the damn thing was too big to fit in the hallway. And so basically I have what they call it is a Delrama lens from Technirama process, which is a 1.5-to-1 squeeze.
Yeah.
And I basically turned that lens on its side and squeezed the...
Okay, so you're literally using the optical characteristics of the lens to fit the...
To fit this character into the hallway.
So I could talk all day just about Star Wars and Raiders for that matter, but I want to get on to Boss because you did tremendous work there.
Yeah.
Films like Die Hard. Well, what were your favorites from that period?
Well, Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
I mean, Ghostbusters was a real nightmare. I mean, it was like... First of all, putting the deal together was a nightmare with the studios because basically we had, the idea was that, first of all, we had to rebuild the studio. When I took the studio over from Doug, it was like a parts drawer. I mean, in other words, Doug's approach to the visual effects is completely different than mine. He doesn't use blue screen. You know, he does matte paintings and stuff that way. We had a much more facile, I think, way of doing things, and we could do a lot more different kinds of shots. But in any case, I had to rebuild the studio. But before that, we had to close the deal, and the deal was to do the visual effects in this new studio that we've taken over, and we're going to rebuild. But we're going to have to share the cost of building the optical printers, for example, with MGM and Columbia. So MGM and Columbia are going to have to co-fund the building of the studio because we're going to do 2010, which is a November release, and Ghostbusters, which is a June release. So they're not competing with each other.
Right.
So that's a good thing. That's the beauty of it. But we still have to put these two studios together. And the lawyers think of every fucking thing imaginable. Sorry about the language. They think of everything imaginable. And consequently, it took a long time to do the deal. And by the time we did the deal, by the time the ink dried on the contract, which in fact was never signed. Actually, it did sign it later. But we didn't sign it right away. But in any case... By the time we had gotten there, we only had 10 months to rebuild the studio, design all the effects, execute them, and get them out. And so it was an incredible amount of work. And
what was the most difficult side of that? Is it the Slimer ghost type effects, or is it the big miniature-y stuff at the end with the rooftop sort of... Because, I mean, you needed a fair huge build for those.
I mean, all of it was difficult. I mean, I wouldn't say that any one thing was more difficult than another. I mean, the animation, the rubberized light, you know, that was the idea. It was, let's rubberize the light. So instead of having this shaft of light come out, we've got this weird...
Well, I've wanted to ask you my whole life, how did those rays coming out of the backpacks? Was it as simple as just...
Oh, you mean the light? You mean
when they're hosing the
guy down with this, Yeah, well, that was animated.
Oh, it was animated.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we had great animators animating that. Terry Wendell, John Bruno, those guys, and Sam Racinos and Anique Terrien. We had a really great crew.
I read somewhere that Multiplicity was one of your favorite films.
Yeah, it was.
Because that was a technical tour de force.
Yeah. Well, actually, Multiplicity was a project where it was interesting because at the end of the project, I thought, I remembered making a statement earlier that if I ever do a show where I feel like it's perfect, it's time for me to retire. And I thought, well, I'm not really ready to retire, but Multiplicity is about perfect. You know, I mean, the shots work. And you can't tell. And the thing that's funny also about that movie is when I went to see it in the theater, when we'd finished it, I was with somebody who was a tech geek, and you know, he'd mentioned this or that for about 5 minutes, and then all of a sudden we just forgot about that and got into the movie and forgot about all the effects. But But it was a very complicated project, and it required the full intellectual capacity of the group at BOSS.
You today do so much work with the ASC,
right,
the Academy, and the VES. I'm kind of struggling to know how I could do that if I had nothing else on and and was, if you don't mind me saying so it's like slightly, you know, like if I was younger than I am today, I would find that hard to keep up the pace. You have a cracking work schedule.
It seems like it, but I mean, it's not that difficult. I am on three boards. I'm on the VES board, the ASC board, and the Academy board.
And all three of those organizations are the premier organizations for those industries.
Right. So, I mean, and I've been in the ASC since 81. And I've been on the board off and on for a good, like, two-thirds of that time, at least.
And just to amplify that, we talked earlier about the SciTech Awards.
Right.
Certainly that's where I saw you last,
right,
at the SciTechs. You have a very active role, not just like generally with the Academy, but with the SciTech Committee. And
right,
the SciTech Committee itself is so different to the sort of the acting side of the thing, because
right,
it involves investigation to
right,
validate. It's not a popularity or an expression of support from the general voting process
right,
that we're used to. It's a very detailed account of who has.
It is, but I mean, we have some really, really smart people, and the thing is, it's a volunteer situation, and with the volunteers, they spend ridiculous time on these projects. I mean, yes, I heard the group. You know, I mean, it's like there's about 50 engineers involved on the group, and we have a very, very good attendance rate. I mean, most people, people show up for the meetings. We only have a couple of meetings a year. We have two main committee meetings, and they were preceded by steering committee meetings. And then there's a couple of other along the way meetings.
Somebody's on that committee and contributing, and they have to fly in. I mean, they pay for that themselves. This really is a volunteer.
Yeah.
And, of course, it's a tremendous thing to volunteer for, but nevertheless, you are relying
right,
on very serious people giving up serious amounts of time.
Right, and we do have a reasonably good Skype situation set up. Last meeting, we had three people that were, at least one of them was, like, very important, you know, to be on the DITS committee. We have the Digital Imaging Technology Subcommittee. Now we have the Digital Apparatus Technology
Subcommittee. Which is the new subcommittee.
That's a new one. But now we're dealing with the micromirror technology, the Texas Instruments, which is mind-blowing technology. I mean,
Could you just clarify for people what the difference is between the DITS, which has been established for some time, and this new apparatus? What qualifies as an apparatus?
Well, DITS is software and DATS is hardware.
Right. I just feel like the Academy is such a unique organization, and I think it's really important that it does reward the technicians, because I just don't want to see a brain drain that causes us to not be able to have the science matching the art as we move forward.
Well, yeah, and the thing is, I totally agree with that. And the thing is that the technology of movie making has become really, it makes your brain hurt to think about it sometimes. I mean, it's so complicated. And you know, you have on the one hand, like this year, for example, we're looking forward to honoring the micromirror projection system, the DLP. I mean, it's just unbelievable technology. I mean,
yeah,
like millions of mirrors flopping around repeatedly.
If you drew it on the whiteboard, you'd say, "Well, that'd never work."
I mean, it's like, you know, nanotechnology. Mm. You know. Anyway, that's a really amazing thing, and it's true. I mean, the Academy, I call the Academy the Vatican of the movie industry. I mean, it kind of is. I mean, it's and the movie industry is very fortunate to have the Academy, which is self-funded through the show. I mean, we make a fortune every year, and so the Academy is like a very wealthy a nonprofit, and
yeah,
so we do a lot of things. And one of the things is the the technology. I mean, over 10 years ago now, resuscitated the technology committee, the SciTech council. And so the SciTech council deals with digital archiving problems and some of these things that face the industry that all the studios are concerned with. And so it's sort of like the 1930s over again. I mean, it's like the last time something this groundbreaking happened to the business was when sound came in.
Right.
You know, so.
Yeah. Well, look, to take nothing away from the ASC, which is also a terrific organization.
The ASC has actually been very valuable as well.
Plus they have a great clubhouse.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
But the work of the Academy overall is tremendous. And your contribution to it has been acknowledged by the Academy, and rightfully so.
Well, I'm glad to be here to do that. I mean, it's been a love of my life, you know.
Well, it's been the joy of my visit to be able to sit and talk to you, sir. Thank you
so much. Thank you.
Wow. And you know what? I have to say, Richard was so kind with his time. Thank you. We will try and get the extended version to our FX Guide Insider members. He is just so fascinating. Well, now it's time to have a look at the new term at fxphd. Now, if you haven't checked out the training there for a while, you owe it to yourself to see the amazing training on offer and take your career to the next level.
Hi, and welcome to October 2014, a week video. I'm John Montgomery. I'll be joined by my friend and business partner, Mike Seymour, in just a bit. We're really excited about this new term. We have a lot of cool stuff and new stuff for FXPhD. For instance, we've got Gollum Crowd available on the VPN for the first time, as well as 3D Equalizer. We've got the new version of V-Ray 3.0 available as well. And a really exclusive offer for FXPhD members, and that's early access to the new learning editions of Flare and Flame Assist that run on OS X via the Autodesk beta program. That's really cool. But before we get to that, I just want to start with something that's had a lot of buzz since NAB, and that's Nuke Studio. We've got two new courses this term. The first one covers Nuke Studio, and it's taught by Ugo Guerra, who actually has taught a Hero course for us in the past. The other is a killer advanced course being taught by Nathaniel Westphier, covering the dark art of digital beauty and makeup.
Nuke Studio combines the very powerful and procedural compositing tool Nuke together with the conform tool Hero. It's a great pleasure for me to show you this tutorial because for the past 3 years I've been developing a full pipeline using Hero and Nuke here at the mill. And this is a great opportunity for me to finally share with you some of the production techniques and some of the tricks that I've been learning over the years to do full productions using these two great applications. Nuke Studio has been designed to give you a full suite of tools of compositing, shot management, conform, review, and finishing for visual effects productions, enabling you very collaborative workflows. You will learn conforming from EDLs and XMLs, learn how to manage and organize a full production, deal with versions of shots and timelines, learn to use timeline soft effects, jump backwards and forwards from the compositing and timeline environment, handle the typical issues involving real-world problems, and be presented with real production-driven solutions.
Now, this may not look like digital beauty, but it represents a core underlying technique and art form that will allow us to animate paint strokes and clone strokes, vector painting. Vector painting's been buried away in Nuke, so we'll learn how to unlock it and put it to task for digital beauty work. I'll then dive into digital beauty, taking on and learning about difficult challenges you'll find in production. Using vector paint and other procedural techniques, no clean plates or round tripping here. We'll also learn about how common techniques such as blurring are a bad idea and how you should never use them or use them sparingly. We'll also go into techniques makeup artists use and replicate them digitally.
Several terms ago, we launched our new digital matte painting curriculum led by Ludovic Iacem, a senior digital matte painter at Double Negative in London. Now, those courses are done, but they're available for you to watch as repeats. We've got a new course this term that takes a slightly different approach. It involves a lot of exercises, showing you how to do the exercises, as well as providing feedback for course member submissions in the forums.
The idea for DMP204 is to let you work on projects, and I'm going to give you some feedbacks, reviews of your work. To do that, we're going to split it in four different projects. So here is a quick presentation of the four different matte painting I would like you to work on during this term. So that's the first one. On this one, the idea is to replace the background here by something a bit more interesting, probably some nice mountains, having a better sky, something nicer. For the second one, this one, consider that this is a steel that we want to use as a shot. So it means as a plate for a shot. So it means that we need to get rid of all the elements that could move in this. So it's going to be a lot of restoring. And on the top of that, I would like to give the feel that it's a bit more snowy to place this scene into a winter situation. For this third project, the idea is to extend this type of houses behind this one, this front line, as if there was a mountain or something behind this one. So that we'd be getting rid of all of this and putting probably around here that height, the same type of houses behind this one. And for the last one, taking this, get rid of the guy here, of course, and place this at the top of a mountain and establish a big and very impressive vista. So it's really a term that is going to use all the techniques that we've seen so far in DMP 1, 2, and 3 and try to make some nice images together.
Thanks, John. Well, I'm here to introduce two new courses, two new 100-level courses with brand new products. The first is Introduction to Golem Crowds with Gareth Stevenson. We're really enthusiastic to have this terrific piece of software and Gareth as a new professor. Another new professor that's joining us is Philip Maddock to do our new 3D Equalizer course. This course is in been in huge demand, and Philip's a very senior tracker in London. But I should point out, John and I actually went to the company that makes 3D Equalizer in term two of fxphd. That's just how long we've been talking to the guys and trying to work out how to do a course. So this course is long overdue. But let's first look at the new Introduction to Golem Crowds.
Hi, and welcome to Introduction to Golem Crowd. My name is Gareth Stevenson, and I'll be taking you through this user-friendly crowd simulation tool for Maya. Golem has some great features that give you the ability to quickly create natural-looking crowds, and it's used in production by many studios around the world. I've worked with Golem on four projects, two films and two TV series, and I'll be bringing everything I've learned on these varied shows to this course. In the first week, you'll see how quickly we can go from an empty Maya scene to a basic crowd setup, touching on each of the main tools. You'll be left with a sense of the overall Golem workflow and how the different elements fit together after the first half-hour class. We'll follow that by looking at each stage of the process in detail, taking our original Maya assets, a character skeleton, animation, skin geometry and materials, and converting them for use in a crowd. You'll learn some techniques for getting greater visual diversity from your assets and editing your animations inside Golem. We'll look at how we can use bipeds, as well as a more unusual custom character setup. We'll explore the range of techniques we can use to easily place characters throughout an environment before spending several lessons with the behavior editor, where we'll build a range of character behaviors from a few logical operators, set triggers, and have characters react to events in the scene. You'll learn how to use character locomotion, physics, and geometry animations such as encloth caches with your crowds. While this is an introduction class, and you'll be able to follow along if you're new to Golem, we'll go into detail and cover a wide range of information, so even an experienced user should pick up some new tricks. See you in class one.
Hi everyone, my name's Philip Maddock and I'm going to be taking you through this fxphd course in how to use 3D Equalizer. Now 3DE is an incredibly powerful match move tool, and it's used by all of the major studios to get consistent results on their match moves. And this course is designed to give you a running start into the software. So we're going to start out by diving into 3D's unique and incredibly efficient user interface. We'll take a look at all of the different environments, and we'll talk about setting up our own environments and defining our own presets. And then we'll take this one step further by diving into 3D Equalizer's Python capabilities. Now, if you've never used Python before, don't worry about it. We'll keep it very simple, and I'll take you through step by step. Moving away from looking at the user interface, we'll start to take a look at 3D Equalizer's 2D tracking tools. We're going to go through all of the options, when and how to use specific things, and really just the the best way to get the most out of these. We'll start looking at solving some cameras for some nodal pans and some free moving shots. And we'll talk about a few simple techniques, really going to help you out if you get into a tight spot with your own match moves in the future. And then we'll move on to a few of the more advanced features of 3DE and really start to utilize the 3D environment and create layouts. We'll talk about importing OBJ files from other 3D softwares to really help build layouts inside of 3DE. And eventually, towards the end of the course, we'll move on and start talking about how to use LiDAR and laser scans. And we'll talk about when and how to use lens grids, and we'll talk about how to use parameter adjustments inside of 3D Equalizer to determine lens distortion. Before going through to Warp 4, we'll talk about how to use Warp 4 to render out our dewarped plates.
As I mentioned earlier, we have exclusive access to the new learning editions of Flare, Flame Assist, and even Flame for our members this term at fxphd. It's really a great way to learn the software, and it's much more accessible than it has been in the past. And for that reason, we have a new 100-level course focusing on Flame Assist and Flare. It's being taught by a new prof at fxphd, Michael Fury.
For the past 12 years, I've been working as an editor and a compositor on Autodesk software, specifically Flame. That being said, I've carefully designed each of these 10 classes to get you comfortable with the application and teach you very specific skills that would be expected of someone working at a visual effects house, a post-production facility, or a broadcast company at a beginner to intermediate level. I'll teach you how to properly set up a project and create a user profile. I'll show you how I set up my preferences and how they impact my workflow. Then, I'll teach you how to conform a timeline from an offline edit using an XML or an AAF file. I'll show you how to navigate and work in that timeline. We'll build some composites, work with alpha channels, and I'll teach you several different color correcting techniques using both the timeline effects and working in batch effects. Then, we'll tackle some more complex issues such as tracking, painting, and we'll jump over to Flare and work on a green screen composite. By the end of this class, you'll have a good solid understanding of Flame. I look forward to meeting you online in the forum, and thanks for watching.
Several terms ago at fxphd, I led a course called The Reluctant Sysadmin, kind of based on my experience of being dragged into system and administration duties. Another parallel to that is I'm the guy who got dragged into doing all the web stuff for fxguide and fxphd. And based upon the feedback from that original course, as well as talking to you guys at FMX, it seemed to be a real need to kind of build upon building your web presence online. Because, of course, it's really incredible. If you don't have a good web presence, either through Google searches, a nice website, or sharing stuff with the client, you're pretty lost. So what we're going to do is kind of start off where sysadmin left off. And that's kind of building your site in WordPress, as well as showing you various third-party tools such as Cloudflare and Amazon CloudFront to actually accelerate your site. Things like New Relic for monitoring your website, as well as things like doing advertising using Google AdWords, as well as simply building your presence so you get great response in Google search results as much as possible. Again, it's really important to have a strong web presence, whether you're a company or a freelancer, and this course will really show you how to get that job done.
One of the other courses I'm really enthusiastic to discuss is the new DOP course, where I can invite back Ben Allen. Ben, how are you?
Good, thanks, Mike.
So we've done a lot of stuff over the years where we've done some extremely complex stuff. We've tented entire houses and done cool stuff, but yep. We've never tried to make you shoot like we're going to do this term.
Sounds scary.
So we're going to do stuff with natural light. Basically, we want to look at, well, what it takes, how to control. Maybe that's the wrong way.
Yeah, well, control, work with, and just explore the idea that just because you're working with natural light doesn't mean that you're not lighting. You can still take control of the lighting, and there's lots of techniques and tricks that you can use to light with natural light. And we'll look at trying to recreate natural light with artificial light.
Yeah, which is incredibly hard. So all of that and more coming up this term, which I think will be a really, really good term for many of you who are trying to get that very, professional look, but yeah. Still look very, very natural.
Yeah.
As far as applications go, Houdini is one of those we get a lot of requests for, and it's one reason why you see a lot of Houdini courses here at fxphd, because, well, you guys asked for it. This term, we've got a bit of a different approach. We've got a new prof, Stephen Tucker, who's going to take us through a different type of effects this term.
Houdini is a tool that's become invaluable in production for its ability to simulate life like fire, smoke, water, and explosions. But one thing to keep in mind is that Houdini's real strength lies in its ability to compartmentalize and procedurally manipulate data. In this course, we're going to take a look at a common effect, the force field. It's an effect that appears quite frequently in games and film and can have as much or little complexity as you want. We're going to spend some time analyzing ways that this effect has been used in the past, and then dive into Houdini to create our own. We'll focus on workflow and build up your understanding of the software to learn reliable techniques that will help you craft your future shots. While we won't be focusing on simulation-heavy tools in this course, we will be taking a look at how to manipulate geometry using expressions, particles, recursive operations, vex and channel operators, as well as a little bit of rendering and compositing.
And now to rendering and our V-Ray 102 course. Now, we've had successful V-Ray courses in the past, but this is our first with version 3 of V-Ray. And it actually represents the start of a whole brand new curriculum for us here at FXPhD.
This course will take you through working with V-Ray for Maya 3.0 to get you experienced quickly and gain a base level of understanding for the V-Ray workflow. This class is oriented for beginners to V-Ray rendering, as well as to those wishing to transfer their knowledge from one package to another. We'll start with V-Ray for Maya's interface, which is well integrated into the main Maya UI and is intuitive and pretty easy to get used to. We'll move on to V-Ray lights, which give you an accurate control over the illumination of your scene. They offer you flexibility no matter what you're lighting. We'll move then to V-Ray materials, which offer you a way to shade your objects for best use when rendering. Global illumination mimics real-world lighting, and using indirect light with V-Ray is pretty straightforward to use. With a variety of combinations and options, we'll see how GI benefits your scene and how best to control GI. We'll also take a look at how to add a sun and sky system to your scene very quickly. Then, rendering your scene for most control in post requires a robust pass output system, also known as AOVs. We'll take a look at how V-Ray handles AOVs, called render elements, for ultimate control in composite. We'll even take a look at how to put the passes back together using After Effects.
And now to our Maya 221 course, which is part of our Foundations of Maya series, which was started last term with Professor Matt Leonard. This term, we're actually moving on to look at animation. This is an intermediate level course. I'll let Matt tell you about it.
We're looking to cover both character and non-character based animation over the 10 weeks, starting with the fundamental building blocks of animation, keyframes. From there, the classes will be broken down into a number of key areas, including path animation, creature sets, non-linear animation, and animation layers. In the second part of the course, we'll be looking at building rigs using joints, IK systems, skinning, and constraints. And towards the end of the course, we'll be focusing on the art of animation, including looking at the 12 basic principles of animation taught by Disney animators Ollie Johnson and Frank Thomas. Throughout the course, we'll be covering the main animation editors as well, including things like the graph editor and dope sheet. We'll be also looking at expressions, grease pencil, camera sequencer, and also how end dynamics can work with traditional keyframe animation. This course is going to be aimed at anybody interested in animation in Maya and will be taught using the latest version, currently Maya 2015 Extension 1.
Well, in addition to everything else, you get the free course Background Fundamentals, which is kind of like a weekly magazine-style show that covers new tech, what's going on in the industry, and the business side of the things that we do. All of that plus the VPN software. In addition to everything else we've ever had, we're adding in some new software this term, including the Gollum Crowds, V-Ray version 3 for both Maya and Max, and also we're adding in Nuke Studio. It's just an amazing set of software, so you can check it all out at fxphd.com, including the instructions on setting it up and how to run the VPN.
Well, that's it for this week video. We really appreciate you taking the time to watch. I want to also remind you that we've got a ton of great repeat courses in the vault, well over 100 on offer. But that wraps it up for this. For everyone at FXPHE, thanks so much for watching. We hope to see you in the forums.
Well, that's it for this week, but we'll be back soon with heaps more. And please, if you can support us via our Insider program, we have great shows coming up, including our 200th episode. Until then, see ya.
More industry news, in-depth features, podcasts and forums, check out fxguide.com. And for visual effects training, check out fxphd.com.